It's hard to understand how science works if you don't understand how scientists act upon the incentives that scientific institutions provide them. And that has been a real challenge for research in this area, because up until the very recent past, we tended to study science at the level of aggregates, such as sometimes entire countries or maybe universities. And fortunately, advances in IT and the internet, Google, LinkedIn, and so on, have now allowed us to put together massive amounts of data on individual scientists, being able to sort of keep track of where they are across time and space for long periods of time, and being able of measuring their productivity in a very precise way. One thing that people have been wondering for a long time is, what are the costs and benefits of scientific collaboration? And it's a very interesting question, but it's a very difficult one to ask, because people do not choose their collaborators at random. So in this research, what me and my co-authors have done is to focus instead on the question of what's happening to individual scientists when one of their prominent collaborators is in some sense taken out of their network because he or she dies suddenly and unexpectedly. And what we find is that the productivity of those collaborators declines quite sharply, but also never recovers. So it's sort of a permanent loss in output. So that's sort of the first finding. But what's even more, I think, interesting is understanding the types of collaborators that are more or less affected by this event. And what we find is that, in some sense, is the entire field around the extinct superstar that atrophies following the death of this individual. I don't have a clue, but I know how we should try to find out. And there's one word: experiment. The project of my life is to convince the scientific community that the way to figure out how things work is to actually subject our hypotheses to systematic, randomized, controlled experiments. And that's something that scientists have been typically very reluctant to do. And they think that the scientific method applies everywhere except to themselves. And so what really is needed here is a change of mindset, where instead of just listening to very accomplished and very well scientists to figure out what to do, we actually use their ideas as potential hypotheses, and we subject them to very rigorous tests, just like we would for a scientific experiment. Mostly, I like to spend some time with my daughters. They are 3 and 5, and they bring me and my wife a lot of joy, sometimes some heartache and some gray hair, but mostly it's quite wonderful. The other thing I like to do is to bike. In particular, I've now become a bike commuter. We have this wonderful new building at Sloan with showers in the basement, so one thing that I've really enjoyed doing since the beginning of this school year is to actually bike from my house in Newton to MIT every morning and back.